How are you tonight? It's nice to see everybody here. Praise God. God got us here, and God drew us in closer still. Let's open with prayer. Oh, Heavenly Father, thank you for this night. Thank you for we gather in your name, and thank you for being in our midst. Thank you, Lord, for drawing us closer still. Thank you, Lord, for your word, your breath breathed on these pages that we can live life, that has given us life and life more abundantly through your sacrifice on the cross, Lord. Oh, Lord, in the beginning was the word. You are the word, Lord. So thank you, Lord. Thank you. Thank you for giving us your word, your spirit, your love, and salvation, Lord. Oh, Lord, we love you. We dedicate this night to you, Lord. Help us to have ears to hear and a heart to act on it. We want to be doers of your word, not just hearers, Lord. And Lord, help us to be bold in you, in love, Lord. Let us be the light of Christ, the aroma of Christ, the salt of the earth, the light of the world, because of you, Lord. So thank you. Be glorified tonight, Lord. All honor, praise, and glory is yours, for you are worthy of all our praise. And we pray this in the loving name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
All right. Hard to worship, everybody. When the music fades and all is stripped away, and I simply know this one because we just did it yesterday. Listen to our hearts. That goes from east to west and runs as deep as it is wide. You know all our hopes, Lord, you know all our fears. And words cannot express the love we feel, but we long for you to hear. So listen to our hearts, hear our spirits sing. Song of praise that flows from those you have redeemed. And we will use the words we know to tell you what an awesome God you are. But words are not enough to tell you of our love. So listen to our hearts. If words could fall like rain from these lips of mine. If I had 1,000 years, I would still run out of time. But if you listen to our hearts, every beat will say, thank you for the life, thank you for the truth, thank you for the way. So listen to our hearts, hear our spirits sing. Song of praise that flows from those you have redeemed. And we will use the words we know to tell you what an awesome God you are. Words are not enough to tell you of our love. So listen to our hearts. Listen to our hearts. Hear our spirits sing. Song of praise that flows from those you have redeemed. And we will use the words we know to tell you what an awesome God you are. Words are not enough to tell you of our love. So listen to our hearts.
Good evening again. We are, good evening. We are Freedom Through Christ. I'm going to remember my ritualistic routine here. We are a fellowship of men and women who come together for the purpose of receiving freedom from the sin of addiction or any sin that binds us, because we believe that sin is addiction. Anything that's habitually repeated continually over and over that makes us rationalize, justify, become very deceitful about what we're doing and how we're living is addiction, is bondage, is slavery. We receive this freedom through Christ by accepting Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior first and foremost. And for anyone that's backslidden, to recommit your life back to Christ. Jesus is calling you closer still now. It's all through him, by him, and in this world, there's so much more evidence of now's the time to come back to Jesus or to know Jesus at this point. We receive this freedom through worship as we just did. Our hearts are lifted up, creating us a clean heart, the heart of worship. Oh, listen to our hearts, from our hearts to God's ear. We do a study of God's word, which we're about to do. We will pray at the end, and we fellowship. And we're back to breaking the Philly soft pretzel as breaking of the bread. But even though we have to take it home with us, it's still, we're breaking the bread. And for me, mine was delicious tonight. Hot, spicy mustard on it. Look out, man. We believe that whom the Son sets free is free indeed. Thank Amen. You, Lord. Thank you for your word. Thank you for
and
your
I'm
freedom.
I'm thankful yes. that all the chairs are back in the sanctuary.
Praise God. Praise God. Yes. Slowly but surely, the Lord's restoring and renewing us back to our former state, and even better then because of his spirit alive and working in this church and in us. So, Carl, where are we at, brother? Galatians chapter 5, gang. Verse 2, right? But before I get started, the Lord put on my heart some things that I want to share with you. So, you know, and it comes from Galatians 5:9, even though we're not there yet. A little leaven spoils the whole lump. And we're going to come to that. And the Lord showed me this morning and during the course of a couple of days, there's too many distractions from our primary purpose. Cares of the world, deceitfulness of riches, lust of the eyes, pride of life, lust of the flesh. And it's all going on, and it's all bombarding us, and it's all coming at us 24/7. Propaganda on TV, different stories, different things, different ways to be better, to be a better you. Jesus Christ is our all-sufficient sacrifice. He's our all in all. I could do all things through Christ who strengthens me. So there's too many distractions from our primary purpose, Jesus. And it can take us away from Jesus, and it can become a law of our minds. You remember our discussion that we talked about how the spirit that was in the law of the Judaizers and how the Judaizers wanted the new believers in Christ to become Jews, and they wanted them to study the law and keep the law. Well, that same arrogance, that same self-righteousness, that same self-centeredness, that same pride of life, that same spirit in the Judaizers is in the message that we get distracted with today. And when we take our mind and make a law out of something and become so absorbed with it, we become just like the Judaizers in the fact that we're about now we become self-righteous. Now we become self-centered. Now we've been distracted from the true message of the gospel. And so in that vein, all that we are told by Paul is to stand fast, hold the line, continue, be sober-minded. be fixed, steadfast, fixed, and immovable. A law can take us, we can make a stand for non-existent virtues. Because what is our true virtue? Jesus Christ. Anything that's virtuous, anything that's a good report, anything that's noble, anything that's truth. Jesus, characters of Jesus. But when we get on our own soapbox, we stand up and we become self-efficient, sufficient, and we start to preach these kind of attitudes and our own self-centeredness rather than the love of Christ. We've been distracted. And this is what the Judaizers were doing to the Galatian church, distracting them from the true freedom in Jesus Christ. Yes, we can disagree, but not be disagreeable. Yes, we can have an opinion, but not make the opinion the bigger picture than the love of Jesus Christ. Yes, we can have a cause and be involved, but Christ should be the primary cause. And how do we bring Christ in that movement or in anything that we find passionate? Christ is our passion, first and foremost. And when we get distracted from that, it's very easy to go down the course of self-centeredness. And for me, who's been set free from the sin of addiction, my core is self-centeredness. And when I'm totally self-centered, I'm about to show you how I want to live. And I, where do you get a load of me after I start thinking this way? Then the next thing I'm off thinking I'm getting you and killing me. This is how subtle it can be. And this is the depth of what happens. And it may not appear that way to you, but think spiritually minded. Go from the spiritual eyes, not the soulful eyes of our feelings and emotions. The spiritual eye starts in the Word of God and in our spirit, and we know it's true. So keep your mind and keep your eyes on the Lord first. Remember, if you can't say you are doing it unto the Lord and bringing the Lord in what your passion is now, then we're off the straight and narrow, and we're on the path of self-centeredness, self-righteousness, self-absorption, and back out the door. And that little bit of distraction will take you and grieve and quench the spirit to where now all of a sudden your indifference and intolerance towards the body of Christ becomes more obvious. Don't allow that. Don't allow that. Stand fast. Stand guard. Come to your first love, Jesus Christ. He is life.
Now, through that, I have Romans 14, and I'm going to run around Romans for a quick second or two. One person esteems one day above another. Another esteems every day alike. Let each be fully convinced in his own mind. He who observes the day observes it to the Lord. Okay? And he who does not observe the day, to the Lord he does not observe the day. You see the point there? The point is, the Lord is the head, first and foremost. The Lord is the primary purpose of how I live and why I live. That's 14:5. He who eats, eats to the Lord, for he gives God thanks. And he who does not eat, to the Lord he does not eat and give God thanks. Do you see what we're saying here? That the Lord is involved with all of this. And we're not to get angry or judge or dislike a fellow church member or a brother in Christ because they don't agree with us or because they don't believe like us. But we're to love. We're to carry the gospel in all our affairs. How can I bring Christ into these situations? Well, I'll tell you, you have a political discussion, you can certainly tell people this is why we need Jesus. You talk about social unrest, you can go in that crowd and say, this is why we need Jesus. Jesus knew no color. There was no Jew, there was no Greek, there was no Scythian, there was no barbarian, there was no male, there was no female. Jesus looks on the heart. You can bring Jesus into every one of these COVID-19 situations. Fear. God did not give us a spirit of fear. You can edify and encourage everyone through every situation in Jesus Christ today. and you will have fulfilled your primary purpose to carry the gospel according to Matthew 28, 26, wherever that was at the very end. Go out and preach the gospel in all the world and baptize in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. This is how we got to remember the kingdom. Seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and then all these things are added to it. If you truly believe in Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, don't you want to share that rather than some knowledge, rather than some idea, rather than some philosophy? Christ is all. Christ is life. Share that life. Share that gospel. Share. It can be applied to every area of my life. He who eats, eats to the Lord, for he gives thanks. For none of us, listen, lives to himself, and no one dies to himself. For if we live, we live to the Lord, and if we die, we die to the Lord. Therefore, whether we live or die, we are the Lord's. Go down into 12. So then, each of us shall give an account of himself to God. Therefore, let us not judge one another anymore, but rather resolve this, not to put a stumbling block or cause to fall in our brother's way. I know and am convinced, now I'm down to 14, by the Lord Jesus Christ, that there is nothing unclean of itself. That's our freedom in Jesus Christ. But not everything's profitable for us. Nor, if it offends our brothers, should we be able to not surrender it, to not bring a brother and make a stumbling block for him. Look, I know and am convinced by the Lord Jesus that there is nothing unclean. But to him who considers anything to be unclean, to him it is unclean. Yet, if your brother is grieved because of your food, you are no longer walking in love. Do not destroy with your food, with your beliefs, with your passions, with whatever things in life that you're involved with. Do not destroy with them the one for whom Christ died. In other words, don't resent your brother if they don't agree with you. Don't hate them. Don't be angry with them and want to separate from them if our belief systems aren't the same about politics. Don't be so awfully hurt and get touchy-feely and fretful when we don't see what you see as far as the knowledge of the world in your certain situation. You understand what I'm saying? I'm trying to say Jesus is the most important thing we could be in. And in that, we have to think how we can do and preach the gospel in every circumstance we're in. Especially if you believe we're in the end times. It's so important now. For the kingdom of God is not eating or drinking, but righteousness and peace and joy in the Holy Spirit. For he who serves Christ in these things is acceptable to God and approved by men. Therefore, let us pursue the things which make for peace and the things by which one may edify another. So this is the key here, look, guys. I wanted to get this that the Lord put on my heart. When I say, one say they are for this or that and not go along with God's word. In other words, it's God's word that we have to be able to answer, and God himself with how we're living. The Holy Spirit will not oppose himself from God's word. If God's word says, esteem others higher than yourself, esteem others higher than yourself. He's not going to tell you, yeah, but it's okay for you not to when you're so passionate about something. God told me not to work. Well, it says in Scripture that if a man don't work, he don't eat. Well, God told me not to come to church. Well, it says in Scripture that forsake not the gathering of believers and the breaking of the bread. So the Holy Spirit's not going to contradict himself. He'll convict me, and that's where it begins. The Holy Spirit, again, like I said, will not oppose our hearts. We must inventory our hearts. Are we in freedom through Christ? Then we won't be angry or resentful or divisionary. Listen, if we're truly in freedom, I can live and let live because I know who I am in Christ Jesus. And I can love you and I can accept you and I can be okay that you don't agree with me, that you don't believe like me. I'm not going to get my heart into, she's going to say, ain't going along with what I believe. I'm done with them. Boo. You get a root of bitterness. You get anger. You get resentment. And it goes to hatred. All those things are breeding grounds in my heart for me going back out and using some kind of sin. And I'm not saying that that's the first thing, because it can happen slowly. It could be a slow death. All right, so listen, false teachers and teachings are everywhere. Let me tell you, even in good things, okay? Like watching too many preachers on TV. Be alert, be alert, be alert, be alert. Because even though they sound good, and even though some of it's the word of God, there's a slight slant here, a slight slant there. You're being fed by a man who loves God, who serves God, who has the desire to study to show himself approved, and only wants to be taught and continue to learn in the Lord and to teach the Lord, Pastor. And this church loves you. And we do everything to stay line by line, verse upon verse. We offer devotionals. We offer Monday night, Wednesday night, Sunday. We have breakfast. We try to do fellowship. Grow roots where you're planted. The Lord called you here. Commit. Stay involved. Be like the trees planted in the waters, the cedars of Lebanon, next to the river. Psalm 1. All right? Listen, don't become disunified, because what happens is too many teachers can create disunity. Now, oh, I heard this from so-and-so. Oh, I heard this from so-and-so. It kind of goes with what we teach. Stay focused. Stay being fed. Primary cause, you stay unified, the body, single-minded in the word of God. Listen, word of God. And if you don't think, be a Berean Christian and read it and study it and get to the root of it for yourself. It's better than watching the news all the day. All right? Now listen, if I can't say I'm doing it unto the Lord and be at peace, then I need to check my motives. That's what the law will do to us. It will make us resentful. It will make us angry. It will eventually make me rebellious from God's word, God's will, into my self-will run riot. You tell me I can't do something, and I'm going to want to do it. But with Christ, we can do all things through Christ who strengthens us. God our Father and Jesus Christ are in control. Now is not the time to go away from your first love. Now is the time to run to your first love. Resist the temptation to follow some world's view and show Christ's love by speaking his word in love. In Wawa, hey, God bless you. Hey, be courteous. Hold the door. Bring your neighbor's trash cans in. Whatever. That's the way we show God's love, in these little acts. Commit to one church. Study the word. Forsake not the gathering of believers. Break the bread. Worship and praise God. Pray without ceasing. Fellowship with like-minded people. My mother used to say to me, show me who you go with and I'll tell you what you are. Okay? Now, it was a little rough around the edges, but it spoke truth to me. If I hang out with second story guys, I'm going to commit second story crimes. If I hang out with people of God that are like-minded and studying the word of God, I'm going to desire more and more of that. Dirty rubs off on clean a lot faster than clean does dirty. So this is some of the things we are we doing this? Stand for Jesus or fall for anything. He is coming back and the signs are all around us. Be prepared. Abide in Christ. Stand fast in the knowledge of Jesus Christ. Satan is a deceiver. He's chaotic and he's divisionary. Now, a couple of things while you're watching these preachers, I want you to be alert to false teachings. One, overemphasis of prosperity. There's nothing wrong with prosperity, but when there's an overemphasis on it, let the red flags come up. Exaggerated view of grace. Oh, my grace covers me. I can sin like a dog and come back and grace and grace and grace and grace and grace. Heaven forbid, Paul says. What, shall we sin then, that grace abounds that much more? We who have been set free, why would we return to the vomit? Again, against law, anything, any law, Jesus did not set us free to sin. He set us free from sin. Amen? Deification of man. When we start putting men on pedestals and the man starts putting himself on a pedestal, you'd be on guard of that. Challenging the authority of God's word. Well, you know what? Evolution may still consider God's word. No, in the beginning was the word. Adam and Eve, so forth and so on. We've seen where there's been heads of church talk about evolution being possible and probable. Head of a church. Rejecting hell. Oh, there's no hell. We don't go. The hell is right now. Oh, we don't go to hell. Be alert. Universal reconciliation. When you hear somebody tell you, well, God loves you, you're going to go to heaven anyway. But that's not God's word. There's only one true God, and there's only one way to the Father through Jesus Christ. Amen? Yeah. More than one way to God. When you hear that we're all kumbaya, can we all get along? We all pray to the same God. Run. Let them antennas come up. Yes, amen. Is everything you do being done in love? Love of Jesus? Jesus is our life. Jesus is life. Catch the vision. Catch the revelation and run with it. That's the revelation to catch. That's the vision to catch. Jesus is life. And everything you touch should have an example or a way that preaches and shows the love of Jesus Christ. Because you've been saved at a high cost. Amen? I've been saved at a high cost. We've all been saved. Spilt his precious blood for us. Separation from his Father for that time. Awful beaten. Betrayal. Abuse. You want to talk about everything we can feel and experience as an earthly, as people here, as humans? Jesus, that much more. Amen. So I said all that to get started with the study now, gang, all right? But that's what the Lord put on my heart, and I felt it was appropriate because a law of our mind, the law of the world, the law of social media can feed us and get us so locked into it that now we want to believe that we're self-righteous, just like the Judaizers did to the Galatian church. See, there's nothing different under heaven. There's nothing. Man's heart can still be wicked without Jesus Christ. And man's heart can be sinful with Jesus Christ. But we need to repent and come back. Amen. All right, chapter 5. Stand fast, therefore, in the liberty by which Christ has made us free, and do not be entangled again with the yoke of bondage. Indeed, I, Paul, say to you that if you become circumcised, Christ will profit you nothing. And I testify again to every man who becomes circumcised that he is a debtor to keep the whole law. You have become estranged from Christ, you who attempt to be justified by law. You have fallen from grace. For we, through the Spirit, eagerly wait for the hope of righteousness by faith. For in Christ Jesus neither circumcision nor uncircumcision avails anything, but faith working through love. You ran well. Who hindered you from obeying the truth? This persuasion does not come from him who calls you. Remember, a little leaven leavens the whole lump. I have confidence in you, in the Lord, that you will have no other mind. But he who troubles you shall bear his judgment, whoever he is. Let's stop there. Yep, Paul says it there, right? And you see what the Lord gave me from Romans and from where the Lord was at with this. And why? What does this have to do with us staying clean and free? Because the field of our heart, when it's contaminated and when it starts to get those kind of weeds that can grow. Weeds of resentment, weeds of anxiety, weeds of anger, weeds of hatred. Those kind of weeds start to prop their ugly head in our souls and in our hearts, and that makes the ground fertile for seven demons to come back. And when that happens, for a guy like me, it could be drugs, it could be alcohol, it could be gluttony, it could be any of the sins that we talk about. And that's why we talk about this, the matter of the heart. Keep your heart clean. Don't let it get bogged down. Don't start taking on this extra, even though you feel righteously and justified, even though you feel just you're so right that this is so right, that's so right, and I'm so right. That's a bad spot. Jesus is so right. Jesus in you. Jesus is the righteousness. So that's why we bring this up, because it comes back to freedom from sin of addiction, freedom from the sin of bondage of hatred, anger, resentment, fear. That's a burden. That's bondage. Make you sick. That's right. So Paul, verse 2. Indeed, I, Paul, say to you that if you become circumcised, Christ will profit you nothing. Circumcision does not save us. Only Jesus saves us. Amen. Hebrews 4:2 as a cross-reference.
For indeed the gospel was preached to us as well as to them, but the word which they heard did not profit them, not being mixed with faith in those who heard it.
So anything that's done outside of faith is sin. Romans, it's scriptural. Have everything.
Well, what do you mean, Pastor Mark? I'm going to the store.
Go to the store in faith. That maybe I'll run into somebody and I'll believe, be able to witness Christ to them, even in some kind small deed.
Well, you know, that's ridiculous. That's not the
faith, the size of a mustard seed that grows into this mighty tree, can move a mountain.
If you make a law out of some cause, some belief, and impose it on others as righteous, you now have taken Jesus out of the spirit of love. Jesus becomes secondary, if at all, involved. And that's what the Judaizers were doing by making the new believers get circumcised. They were taking Jesus out and making the law and getting circumcised, the ritual and the circumcision, as an act that brings you closer to God, as an act that makes you righteous, as an act that makes you better than what you were before what Christ did on the cross. Yes, circumcision of the heart, not of the flesh. We can't add to our salvation and what he did for us. Just as the Judaizers were making new believers get circumcised and get their Jewish on, okay? You know, keep this festival, get circumcised, keep this full moon, go to the different feasts. Christ freed us from any kind of ritual. If you do these things, now listen, guys, I'm going to go back to some of these things. Do whatever you do, do it unto the Lord. If you choose to get circumcised, well, not you guys, but... But if you choose to fast, if you choose to tithe, do it under the Lord, not under man. And if you can't do it under the Lord, then don't do it. Don't do it out of compulsion, of guilt, of anything else that man, of being seen by man. Do it out of compulsion of love of Jesus Christ. And then all things are free to us. You want to fast? God bless you. Do it under the Lord. Don't let me know about it, though. And wash your face and clean your hands and go about with a smile on your face. You want to give tithes and offerings? Don't let your right hand know what your left hand's doing, but let your heavenly Father in heaven sees what you're doing. You do a good deed, do it under the Lord, and don't worry about who spotted you. Look, I know. I like the pats on the back.
I sometimes need the encouragement. But the key is, first and foremost, no, it's unto the Lord. They believed that they knew better. They believed, the Judaizers, they were holier than the new believers. Do we do the same thing when we make something passionate to ourselves and feel that other peoples don't get what I know? I know better. I know deeper truths. They're all not intelligent as I am. They're all prejudiced. They're all sheep being led to the slaughter. They're all foolish people who don't really see what I see. When you get into that heart, it's the same spirit that the Judaizers did to the Jews, to the new believers. Do social practices and religious and knowledge become a law? Do we make them a law? And listen, gang, I've inventoried my own heart. It happens very easily. It happens very easily. And then I got to be careful in ministry. I got to be careful in everything. Because it's very easy for me to start making it a ritual and routine, and I'm this and I'm that. And then I repent. And it happens subtly. See, remember I said it's a slow death? Because the little leaks of compromise come in. Matthew 7, 22 and 23 as a cross-reference. Didn't you have something to add on that other one, too? Okay. All right, Matthew 7, 22.
Right,
it might
we'll
come back
there.
To you.
Many will say to me in that day, Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in your name, cast out demons in your name, and done many wonders in your name? And then I will declare to them, I never knew you. Depart from me, you who practice lawlessness.
Depart from me after doing the good works? Why? Why? Why?
Verse.
Oh, I'm sorry.
I'm sorry. Therefore, whoever hears these sayings of mine and does them, I will liken him to a wise man who builds his house on the rock.
Amen.
We know who that is.
Now, why do you think Jesus says, depart from me, even after these people did these works? They did it for self. They did it out of selfish motives instead of unto the Lord. Now, do we know when our heart's completely selfless? It's difficult, and it's something that you go to the Lord with and ask him to create a clean heart in you and ask him to show you your heart. And then you should know by the fruits that you are not looking for any kind of reward, and that you don't. It's the act itself of giving that's the reward to us already. For me, to be able to freely give and not look for strings attached, that's freedom. That's a reward. That's a gift for me. And may it bless others. He blesses me with the freedom that I was willing to give or willing to do or grateful to do and see it as a blessing because now I'm seeing from spiritual eyes. Okay, so now listen, gang. The Judaizers, now also, for example, our children in college, I have written down here something that struck me about, because they're being taught in the vein of the world and liberal college professors. Now, they're being indoctrinated. Just as I told you before, there's the 24/7 news. There's the 24/7 Madison Avenue marketing. There's the 24/7 bombardment of you need this, need that, whatever else. There's the 24/7 bombardment of this is how we're going to run the world now, and so forth and so on. But we know how the world ends. We know where it began, and we know how to live in the world right here.
Amen.
If you don't buy that, you got to check yourself. Because this is God's breath breathed on these pages, and you can bank your life on this. This is the key. Listen, Jesus is the answer, the focus. He is freedom. And that's when we walk and abide in Christ, we are walking and abiding and living freedom. Oh, here's another thing. Do we believe we are older and wiser? Now, let's go back to the people who struggled with addiction of drugs and alcohol. I've heard this before. Well, I'm older now. I'm wiser now. I've grown up now. I don't touch that. Well, I can handle it. I only had a drink. Bang, off to the races. I've seen others say to me, I'm 75 years old. You think I'm going to do anything? They got out. They went out. They snorted cocaine, and they died of a heart attack. Friends of mine, 2 years clean, sober, knew the Lord Jesus Christ, got involved, compromise after compromise after compromise, went out, did some heroin, fentanyl laced, dead. I wasn't going to do that. I'm wiser. I'm older. I've heard every possible excuse for justifying using drugs. I've been around long enough. Or let me have a near beer. Why would you drink a near beer? I like the taste of beer. Really? Well, start liking something else.
That is a true story. You know, he was drinking that for years.
Yeah.
And then all of a sudden.
Back to it.
And then, whoa, he's in trouble now.
Circumcision, the law. Stand fast because law is not God's way for man to be justified. Right? Romans 9, 31 through 33.
Sorry. But Israel, pursuing the law of righteousness, has not attained to the law of righteousness. Why? Because they did not seek it by faith, but as it were, by the works of the law. For they stumbled and at the stumbling stone, behold, I lay in Zion, a stumbling stone, a rock of offense, and whoever believes on him will not be put to shame. Jesus.
Faith, grace, faith, not works, not keeping a law, not living up to some of these expectations in our mind. Listen, gang, let me get to the point because it's going to come up again. If you think that you're so right in certain points of view and you get so locked in, you're keeping a law. You better be able to live perfectly every other area of your life after that. Think about it. If you're trying to keep the law like the Judaizers did, and if you acknowledge that some law that's become so passionate to you is a law, then and you believe that everyone should think like that or at least know what you're saying as the fact, then you better live perfectly after that. Because now you're expecting everyone else to live like the law of your mind. And you are setting yourself up for disappointment because the first evil thought that runs through your head, you've already broken your own law. It's the same spirit, the same thing. Live. Be free in Christ. Allow people to be where they are. Love them. Hate the sin. Love the sinner. And that keeps our heart in peace and guarded. The peace of God that surpasses all understanding and guards our hearts and minds. Jesus. Amen. Because he died for us that while we were still sinners, he put himself through the humility of esteeming us higher than his own life here, than his relation with the Father for the time, becoming sin who knew no sin. How much more selfless acts of love can his examples be? If a person is ritualized, Christ shall profit him nothing. Ritualized means a person is depending upon some religious thing to make him acceptable to God. Now, it's easy to think about religious things as ceremonies in church, but religious things are anything that we practice over and over and over again. So if you've been meditating on the world system and the world's philosophies and the world's way, it's not going to make you acceptable to God. I mean, it's really not. I mean, you're welcome to have at it, but it's not going to add to the cross. Preaching the love of Jesus Christ, is what we're called to do, and it's a blessing to ourselves. And I'm speaking to me. Listen, guys, I love you. And the only reason I would bring this all up is because the Lord brought it up to me. And I know I have to be on guard in my own heart. And I know I can get self-righteous in my own way. I don't want to make this self-righteousness. But I just love you guys and want to share with you so you can walk in freedom, walk in peace, walk in love, be the light, do all the things, and you'll be blessed for it. And that's where my heart's at. Please, don't misunderstand. I'm not trying to be self-righteous here. If a person is ritualized, he has to do the whole law, okay? He assumes responsibility to live and do the whole law. We can't do it. We can't do it. If we set ourselves up into some law of our mind that I'm going to do this and I'm going to say, the Lord help me, the Lord willing, the Lord guide me, the Lord show me, and then you will see it. Go ahead. Humility. And it's so easy to get off into self-aggrandizing, self-centeredness, self-gratification, self-righteousness. Yeah. And that's what the Judaizers were doing. They were off in, we're smarter than you. We studied the law. We know better. We're holier than you. We've been there, and we've been through all of the rituals, and we know that you need this. Whoa. It's the same spirit. Amen. And knowledge unto itself will puff up. Will puffed up. When we, some of the hardest people that I've tried to be a minister to, ministry, were super intelligent. And it's those intelligent ones that want to use their intelligence as their crutch, as their God, as their justification. Their logical mind, and they couldn't stay clean for a day. I'd rather be a dummy like me and believe, and then the Lord moves and works.
And I was just thinking Amen. Earlier, yes. Like, in our own strength, we'll always fall short.
Amen.
And we won't accomplish much for long. But if we keep giving it to him, he's going to give us the strength.
Amen.
If we ask him.
If a person seeks to be justified by law, Christ can have no effect upon him. Why? Why can Christ have no effect upon him? He's vain. And that vanity begins in where? Self-centeredness, right? If I'm so absorbed with the law and that I'm keeping it, and look at me and watch me and look at how I kept it, you should keep it this way. How can Christ enter into that? There's no faith, and there's no humility, and there's no love. It's all self. And remember what I said. Self-centeredness is at the core of why we sin. I want what I want, when I want it, when I want it. The point is, we must heed the warning lest we begin to deny Christ by making some New Age philosophy, some theory, some social event, some feeling, thought of emotion more important, and take more time from scriptural answers by the Holy Spirit, and can create separation from fellowship with God and from with the church, where our true freedom is in Jesus Christ and all our answers are. We're not going to get the world's answers to be the right answers for us, because we want to be so spiritually minded that we're no earthly good. Did I get it right that time, Irene? There you go. And that's the truth. Verse 3. Oh, did we do Romans 10, 2 through 5? I'm sorry. I'm getting excited.
Yep. It's the Mark show.
Not my show, the Lord's show.
I know, I'm kidding. Kidding. For I bear them witness that they have zeal for God, but not according to knowledge. For they, being ignorant of God's righteousness and seeking to establish their own righteousness have not submitted to the righteousness of God. For Christ is the end of the law for righteousness to everyone who believes. For Moses writes about righteousness, which is in of the law. The man who does those things shall live by them.
Christ is the end of the law. Christ is our all in all. Oh, what does that mean practically to me, Pastor? Well, it means that you seek his word, you find your answers. You study his word, you find what you're looking for. You pray, you believe by faith, you find your life is better. You walk and abide in Christ, all things are possible to those who believe. You continue on in his ways, you'll live a happy, joyous, and free life. And that doesn't mean you'll have a ton of money, a great home, this, that, and the other thing. It means you'll be content and peaceful in any state you're in other than sin, that you will be happy, joyous, and free right where you are because you know the love of Christ.
The joy of the Lord will be your strength.
Amen. Right? Amen. Verse 3. And I testify again to every man who becomes circumcised. He is a debtor to keep the whole law. Paul again reminds us it is not tiresome to repeat himself. Did we hear Paul repeat himself? How many examples has Paul used to show us you can't add to the cross? You can't buy salvation by works. How many times? At least 5, 6 different ways. And he's not tired of doing it. Because I need to hear it every day. I need to be renewed. Why? Because I have so many other things bombarding me. Cares of the world, deceitfulness of riches, pride of life, responsibility, such forth, so forth, my own head, everything else. I need to hear the word of God frequently, daily, and as much as I can. The word of God, I'm sorry, go ahead.
We all do.
Yes. The word of God renews our minds, and Paul testifies, teaches, exhorts again what he's been saying from the beginning. You can't add to our salvation and work on the cross by Jesus because Jesus bought and paid for it all. No matter what there's nothing that we can do, add, say, think, be. It's already done. Receive it. Believe it. Deuteronomy 8:19 as a cross-reference.
Then it shall be, if you by any means forget the Lord your God and follow other gods and serve them and worship them, I testify against you this day that you shall surely perish.
We can make other things gods. We can get so wrapped up into other events and other things and other, even good things, and make them God. If I make this ministry without Jesus Christ being the purpose and it becomes the Mark Show, I've made it an idol. And God forgive me if that's ever been. I want Christ preached, Christ through me, Christ with us. To get to be the glory, to get the glory, and to be the freedom in Jesus Christ.
Amen.
To anyone who does works, gets involved with some cause, ritualizes anything from Scripture without it being done unto the Lord, to try to get right, closer, to make up for some sin, earn some favor, think some social cause other than the cross and the gospel of Christ, you will be a hypocrite because you can't live self-righteous in other areas of your life, and it profits you nothing. It's the love of Christ that compels us, not self. If you can't say, I'm doing this or that because of the love of Christ, check your heart. Check your heart. Ask God to show you. If you're into some anger and hatred and resentment, check your heart. If you can't get yourself and show the love of Christ to what you're involved in, check your reason why you're doing it. And ask the Lord to show you and help you.
And I ask the Lord continually, show me my heart, Lord. I ask before I came out here, please, Lord, let it be you, because I know a lot of this stuff that I'm talking about is deep stuff to me and to the world. And listen, guys, I'd be naive to sit here and say that it's not on people's mind about social unrest, about COVID-19, about the political state of the world, about earthquakes, about killer bees, about locusts that are eating, about fires, about other pandemics and other sickness, but possibly it's on people's mind. But we should not let it consume us, because we should be looking to Jesus and his return. That's where freedom is. When I keep my focus on the Lord and I walk in Christ, progress, one foot in front of the other, stay fixed, immovable, steadfast, and move forward in Jesus Christ. Stay the course. Stand fast. Hold the line. Come to be with your first love, Jesus Christ, his word, his freedom, his love, his grace. Nehemiah 9, 29 through 30.
All right. And testified against them that you might bring them back to your law, yet they acted proudly and did not heed your commandments, but sinned against your judgments, which if a man does, he shall live by them. And they shrugged their shoulders, stiffened their necks, and they would not hear. Yet for many years you had patience with them and testified against them by your spirit in your prophets. Yet they would not listen. Therefore, you gave them into the hands of the people of the lands. That's it.
We reap.
God bless you.
We reap what we sow. The benefits of stiff-necked, hard-hearted, self-centeredness, there's receipts for that. And that's what we have to be alert to. And so just, I say this in love to everybody, and I say it to me, again, to keep myself. Go ahead. Sure.
Nevertheless, in your great mercy, you did not utterly consume them nor forsake them, for you are God, gracious and merciful. So I like to, you know, end that verse like that.
And that's the love of Jesus Christ for us, that we can go to him, ask for forgiveness, and ask for help. I need you, Lord. Lord, I need you every day. So, gang, I'm going to stop here. Brothers and sisters out there, friends, acquaintances that are here on Facebook, God bless you all. Please, listen, you've heard some of this conversation, and you know that these signs and these things in the world that are happening, the Lord is getting ready. Now, even if you don't see it that way, know that we are in perilous times. So now's the time to make the commitment to Jesus Christ. And I don't mean through some religious ceremony. I mean through your personal rapport with Jesus Christ. So please, gang, if you want, right now, just follow me in this prayer. Lord, forgive me, I'm a sinner. Jesus, thank you for the cross. Jesus, come into my heart. Thank you, Lord, for salvation and eternal life in heaven. Amen. Believe in your heart and confess with your mouth, and you shall be saved. God
Amen.
Bless you, gang. We love you out there. I hope to see you again, all right? Praise God. This time is for us.
Praying for you guys.
Yes, yes. All right, gang. I stop. I want to leave the floor open for any opportunity for you to